of Star Trek Lower Decks. Joining executive producers Alex and Rod on stage and here to talk about what the crew of the USS Cerritos are up to in season three, please welcome Alex and Rod. They're already on stage. Executive producer, showrunner, and creator Mike McMahon. Amazing voice cast, Don Lewis, Captain Carol Freeman, Noelle Wells, Ensign Davina Tendi, Jack Quaid, Ensign Brad Boynton, Tawny Newsome, Ensign Beckett Mariner,
Hey there.
I had to bring Rutherford. I had to bring Eugene Cordero. He really wished he could be here, but the boy stays booked and busy, you know?
Oh, yeah. So, Mike, how does it feel to be back bringing Lower Decks to Hall H and these amazing fans?
Wait, can you guys hear me? All right. This is our second time in Hall H, but the first time since we've put a show up. So, it's amazing to be back. We have just been dying not being able to share all of our Star Trek love with all of you guys, and yeah, we couldn't be happier. It's amazing.
Thanks, guys.
Tawny, we know you are a Star Trek fan, and now there are two seasons of Lower Decks out in the world and another one on the way. How does it feel to be a Starfleet officer?
Oh my gosh, it's incredible. It's the only military I would ever join because it's like kindness, space military. Shout out to Space Force, sorry. sorry to my other job that's done. But really the reason why I wanted to come here, no one invited me. I asked to come here because Mike and I, we have a beef that we need to squash.
Sure.
Trek beef.
We have formed such a bond, this crew. We are such a dang family, especially for an animated show. Why don't you let us record together anymore?
Yes.
Why are
we
always
yes.
alone?
Yes. I keep trying to tell Tawny that there's a really good reason that we can't record everybody in a room together the last couple of years, and she keeps yelling at me about it. But someday soon, we'll all be able to be back
just
together.
Just put an iPhone in the center of a room and have us all shout and spit in each other's faces. I don't see the problem.
It does sound beautiful.
There we go.
It does sound beautiful.
All right.
Jack, in the ready room, they debuted a clip showing...
Yeah. Sorry, I love it so much. Sorry, continue.
You were working in your family's raisin vineyard.
Mm-hmm.
How did you react when you first read that script, and how does it feel?
It still feels amazing. That I just love that clip so much. I love that, you know, when we see Earth, we're used to seeing, you know, Chateau Picard, wine vineyards. I love that Boimler works on a raisin vineyard. It's my favorite thing in the world. But Mike, I have one bone. I'm sorry. There's a lot of Trek beef happening on this panel right now.
Trek beef.
Thank you, Noelle. Yes. There was a thing. I get it. You're supposed to like, oh, maybe, you know, you see like a silhouette of someone. You're like, oh, is it Picard? And then it's Boimler. I get it. You don't want to blow the surprise. But in the script, there was a scene where like a moment where the camera would, you know, pan over the vineyard, and then there was a sign that said, Boimler Valley Raisins. It was my favorite thing I've ever seen in my life, and now I demand that Star Trek needs to make a Boimler Valley Raisins in the style of, like, Sunmade. I need that to happen.
Yes.
With Boimler in that exact pose, I need it.
I like that you guys hold your beefs for Hall H.
Oh, yeah.
Air it in front of
you guys. All have my email address if you feel like expressing this stuff at any time, literally of the year.
I communicate exclusively through Hall H.
Through Hall H. Now we have witnesses. We have backup now.
Noelle, the fans have already embraced and loved Tendi. In voice acting, you have to use your imagination so much. How fun is it to see the final product?
This is my first Comic-Con, and I It's so loud. It's my voice. Okay, wow, this has been so fun. It is kind of interesting when you read the scripts, and you know what's going on, and you have to because it's your character, and I put a lot of me in her and the heart, and then actually getting to watch the animation, not only is it being brought to life, and you see it as the character, which she's completely herself, but then there are all these other layers to what Mike and the animators do that weren't in the script that I had no idea would ever be included in the animation. And so it's like doing it all over again, or watching it for the first time, literally watching it for the first time, but getting this whole other experience. And so it's really fun to be a part of something that has so much artistry. Like, I'm just a voice on a level, and then to get to see what gets created around it, it's just an honor. And I have some beef for you, Mike.
No!
I'm just kidding. I don't have any.
More beef!
Dawn, do you have any beef?
No, don't ask Dawn if she has beef. I know she's going to have beef. But wait, before we get to Dawn, Noelle, you give us such amazing performance for Tendi that the artists are working up to what you're giving us.
That is the cool part about animation, right?
That's why you can't have beef with me.
That's why I came up. It's a really loving relationship.
Dawn,
yes.
We know that you have been, like me, a long-term Star Trek fan.
Yes.
And what did it feel like when you got the call that you were going to be the captain of a Starfleet ship?
Okay. I and my three brothers have been watching Star Trek since the very, very first incarnation. We loved it. We learned all the lines, all the symbols, all the everything. So when you grow up, I've always wanted to be some kind of alien warrior, whatever person. So when I got the call to audition for the show, we were not told that it was Star Trek. We were all given the names of animals, like I was Captain McDuck or Captain whatever. And so you go in and you audition and you give your best, you know, I did my best imitation of Captain Sisko and Captain Kirk. That's what I did. And so when they called me and said, you booked the job, it's like, oh yeah, great, I booked another gig. And then they said what it was. I said, I'm sorry, say what? I am a part of the Star Trek franchise. You know how you scream and nothing comes out of your mouth? Like, ah! So I called my brothers and they were like, get out of town, you are lying. I was like, no, this is what I'm doing. And then over the years, you are sometimes fortunate to meet those who inspire you, who change your life. And when I was watching that first incarnation of Star Trek, the person who inspired me and changed my life was Nichelle Nichols. To see this amazingly beautiful, gifted, smart, because could handle herself, woman of color, in outer space, doing her best to be excellent, and everybody respecting her for it. When I grew up and got to actually meet her, I literally cried and couldn't speak. We have since become friends, and Nichelle has a lot of friends who are Leos. She herself is not a Leo, so she would have Leo parties every year at her house. So we would go and we would party, and George Takei would be there, and Walter Koenig would be there, and I had crushes on both of them when I was little. So the first thing I thought of after calling my brothers was to call Nichelle. I said, you will not believe what, I'm getting emotional now, you will not believe what just happened to me. And thank you for shining that light in my life on this space of a universe that is possible, where people work side by side, different cultures, different races, different creatures and creations, and they are excellent and amazing. And she was excellent and amazing for me, and now I get to be in this world as a... Oh, man. Thank you. As a captain, as a woman of color. Come on, y'all. The universe ain't ready. Give me your shirt. I got beef with Mike. Thank you, sweetie. Thank you, Alex. Thank you, Mr. Roddenberry. Thank you. Thank you for creating this amazing world that we get to be a part of. Thank you.
I have one question, and it's for Mike, actually.
Is this beef?
No beef.
Beef?
Every time I see you, your energy level, your geekery for Star Trek is through the roof. You say you love what you do, and this is like the best gift you've ever had. When Are you going to be a character on this?
Wow.
I think a character after you would be spectacular.
I don't know. I like to put incredibly talented actors into stuff, and then I don't like me to show up being like, hey, I'm ruining it. But,
I don't know, that sounded good. That sounded
hey,
good.
Hey, hey, I'm here, I'm yeah. Admiral ruining it. But, I did sneak myself into the background of a Lower Decks episode as a Vulcan, so I'm in there.
Sometimes he does our temp voices. Like when they do the scratch animation and we're not there to do the record, all of a sudden it's like, why does Captain Freeman sound like Mike McMahon? Because it is Mike McMahon. He's living through all of us.
It's amazing stuff that'll never get out into the world. Ever. So, thank God.
So we've shown a little of the season at Mission Chicago and the Ready Room, but with the season fast approaching, it is time to show a full-blown trailer.
Yes.
Yes.
Mike, can you give us a sneak peek?
Yeah.
That is amazing. That is so amazing.
That looks so good.
Is Lower Decks really going to go to Deep Space Nine?
Oh, we circle Deep Space Nine. We check out the pylons. And then we go into Deep Space Nine.
What?
Where we will walk the promenade.
Wow.
We will enjoy the Cardassian architecture.
Will someone lick a Jumja stick? Will someone lick
There's
one
Jumja
of those
sticks?
Jumja sticks?
Yes.
And you might see some friendly faces in there.
Yeah.
It feels to me like one last walk around Deep Space Nine. Like, it's a really great episode. I can't wait for you guys to see it. Yeah. Give it up for Deep Space Nine!
Alex, Lower Decks is so different from the other Star Trek series, but still adheres to prime timeline continuity. Oi! How do you and the other showrunners work together to maintain that continuity between both the past series and the new shows? It's the space-time continuum.
I mean, it's crazy because now with five shows, you really have to make sure you're not stepping on each other's toes.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of crossover because everybody wants to play with the same damn toys. So what we do now is every 2 months, I would say, all the showrunners get together and we all talk and each person downloads what they're doing over the season, what they're thinking about doing over the season, the characters that they want to use. Sometimes there are characters that actually can cross-pollinate into between different shows. We just have to make sure we're synchronizing how that works. So there's a lot of communication in the universe build, which has been great. And it gives all the showrunners a chance to get a sense of how the other showrunners are thinking, which is really exciting.
Yeah, but it spoils everybody's shows for us.
Say it again.
I don't get to watch any of the shows. I know everything that happens on the shows. I don't get to watch Star Trek anymore.
I know. My instinct is always to give you everything because I just want to see what you're going to do with the show.
Rod, what's it like producing a Star Trek comedy? And also, thank you for the Star Trek comedy.
You know, initially I was uncertain how Star Trek comedy would really work out. And I mean, a great tribute to you, Mike, and the entire cast here. Lower Decks is phenomenal. And the amount of references that you have in there, anyone can watch it. You can be new to Star Trek, or you could be probably like a lot of you, love Star Trek. And I don't even get all the references. But it is so intricate, it is so much fun. I don't want to say I was proven wrong, but on some level I was proven wrong. You know, and Star Trek really hadn't done that before. And thanks to you guys, it's doing it, and it's nailing it.
Thank you.
So, great job.
Thank you.
Can we talk about the season 2 finale and how it sets up where we find our beloved Lower Deckers on season 3?
Jack, Tawny, you want to walk us through it?
Yeah.
We had a classic Trek cliffhanger at the end of last season. We had a really great moment with all of us, you know, being a family. We did this amazing thing, and then Captain Carol Freeman gets hauled away in handcuffs. It's awful.
Quickly, Popo got me.
Yeah, it's rough. But we start season 3 like full tilt, looking for, trying to fix it, trying to set it right. And I love the scrappiness. I love episode 1 of season 3 because our lower deckers are just like, we gotta save the captain. It just feels like this epic adventure. It feels like a movie.
I love all their Earth outfits so much.
Earth outfits are banging, y'all. I got a cropped Wilson's leather jacket like Picard in Insurrection.
I got a vest, y'all.
A vest. A real Jake Sisko looking vest.
Yeah.
Tendy's in a sensible, like Linda Hamilton in T2 type tucked in t-shirt situation. What's Rutherford wearing?
It's an asymmetrical sweater.
It's an asymmetrical purple outfit.
Absolutely. Yeah. It's so good.
Jack, what is the thing that surprised you most about your character's evolution these past 3 seasons?
Oh man, I love playing Boimler so much. He's truly one of my favorite characters I've ever gotten to inhabit in any way. I love how confident that he's gotten. It's been so cool. I love that he started out very by the book, very rules focused, and slowly but surely, he's still the same old Boimler, but he's getting more and more confident, and he's getting bolder. And I'm dare I say, proud of him. I'm very proud of Boimler. So thank you, Mike. Thank you for taking him on a really cool
journey. I'm proud of Boimler too, man.
We're all proud of Boimler. He's got a vest.
Yeah.
I'm so proud of him.
It's the proudest I've been of a cartoon.
It's me too.
Do you guys have special warm-ups? I've done some voice acting for animation, and my voice always gets stripped out. It's like so much screaming.
I like to save my voice for that. Just let that come out. Any voice record, there's a bunch of those.
I get tired sometimes because for some reason Captain Freeman is always so high strung. I said, can I whisper something? No, louder, faster, angrier. I need to be calm. We need to see.
Every time you want to be calm, it's like a red alert. There's stuff hitting the shields, and you're like, red alert.
We want to see Captain Freeman after a massage.
Yeah,
after a massage, just chill. Yo, Beckett, why you gotta be so crazy?
Yeah, Beckett. Bold one, then we can have your character cool, you know?
Yeah, my character needs to walk around in shades for
cool
an episode.
Carol. All right, we'll give you more cool Captain.
Captain's not gonna happen. Not gonna happen.
It's more beef. It's beef. The beef finally came out.
Sure. Oh, we have a lot of beef. A lot of beef, my lord.
I think my warm-up is just gossiping with Mike before we start.
Nice.
I get in the booth and I'm like, okay, there's so many things I have to tell you. And he's like, there's so many things I have to tell you. And then Brad, our producer, and our engineers are like, guys, we gotta go.
Yeah, that's Brad's main job at this point. It's just like, guys, we gotta finish this.
I think we all do that. I thought that was just us. We all have like a little chit-chat, catch-up, how's your life
yes,
been session before we record.
We become a family.
We become family.
Well, I hope you all get to get in the same booth again soon.
Yeah, I'd love that.
One booth.
I've still never met Eugene in person.
5 characters.
That's crazy.
I've still never met him. I met him now. I know him. I know him very well now. Hey, Eugene. It's good to meet you, man.
Hey, man.
How you doing, Jack?
Hey,
he has so many voices.
Mike, with season 3 premiering in a little over a month, what are you most excited for the fans to see?
There's so much stuff. I mean, excuse me. Sorry, these guys had me out lower decking last night. There's so much this season I can't wait for you guys to see. There's epic episodes, there's heartfelt episodes. The Deep Space Nine episode is out of control. We've got the nefarious Exocomp Peanut Hamper returning. It's just so much fun, and I've said this a million times, there was a little while where we didn't have any Star Trek. That was a very bad time. And now, we have lots and lots of Star Trek all the time, and on the 25th, on August 25th, when Lower Decks returns, you're going to have 10 new times to be in that world again, to be in the Alpha Quadrant with Starfleet officers, and it's just such a joy to share it with you guys.
I think we have time for a question. Is there a question?
Oh, wow.
I love it.
Yes.
Hell yeah.
This question kind of covers the entire Star Trek universe, but I was wondering if you're ever going to enlist some coneheads in the future.
Some Star Trek coneheads.
Good and specific. I like
that. Yeah, that's about my day grade.
Alex?
Alex?
I'd like to see you want some coneheads.
Who owns the licensing rights on the coneheads? Like, that's the answer to the question.
I think that's Lauren
like,
Michaels.
Why wouldn't we want to put the coneheads there?
It really especially honors the vision of Starfleet.
Yeah.
Starfleet.
Yeah.
I'll tell you this, I'll find a way. I'll get the Conan's in there. I'll do it.
Yeah, do it.
Hi, what's your name?
Hi, my name's Rick.
Hi, Rick.
Hi. You got all your fans here.
Wow, Rick.
So I've got a question for all of you all. So you refer to a Gorn wedding in an episode, and lately we've met the Gorn, which raises a lot of questions. Are these the same Gorn that we see in Strange New Worlds? And if so, what was that reception like?
All right, let me tell you something about Gorn weddings, everybody. Now, Strange New Worlds, there's a couple centuries difference, and you know, you go to where Gorn live, there's not every planet has to be this monoculture,
can we have anybody
right?
Else?
Just like Devon Attendee is an Orion, not all Orions are controlling people with their pheromones. You've also got Orions joining Starfleet. You know, maybe not all Gorn are gonna be treated like this extremely scary thing that bursts out of you, and sometimes they fall in love and get married.
Yeah.
And it's beautiful.
Yeah.
It's beautiful.
Please don't stereotype the Gorn. Just because they're terrifying.
Well, I think that's about all the time we have, and I want to thank
Can you. I say one thing?
Oh, yes.
Oh, sure.
Okay, first of all, when we were here last time, we had nothing to show you guys, so you weren't sure what to expect, but you took this journey with us. And so for the last two seasons, we want to say thank you
thank
for
you
taking
so much.
This journey with us, for trusting us, and for all of us going together where no tune has gone before.
Except for one. Except for Prodigy and the original animated series.
There you go, there you go.
And
thank
you, everybody.
Real quick, just because we're in Hall H, can we do a Lower Decks chant?
You guys want to chant Lower Decks?
Is that okay?
Okay, we're gonna start it Tony? Small and build it tall. Okay. Here we go.
Lower Decks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.